fair to say that Netanyahu is simply waiting for Biden to leave. Kamala Harris's hostility matters less. Victory has to be complete. The Hamas leadership has to be captured, killed, tried for war crimes, and hanged.
This is an interesting time for US-Israel ties. Benjamin Netanyahu is in the US to drum up support, and if one were to look at Israeli Prime Minister's speech to the US Congress, it was full of standing ovations. It may paint a different picture from what the reality actually seems like right now, that Israel seems to be losing the US support for its war in Gaza. Hello and welcome to Decode Exactly What is Happening on Ground. We're joined by Yeshaya Rosenborn, a journalist who's joining us live from Jerusalem. Hi, Yeshaya. Thank you so much for joining us here.
Thank you.
Okay, so what exactly do you see the US-Israel situation to be like right now? Because Netanyahu is in the United States, he's met Biden, he's met Harris, he's given a speech in front of the US Congress asking for support. But Kamala Harris, who's practically the Democratic nominee now, has made it quite clear that it's time for the war in Gaza to end. In fact, a number of Democrats even skipped Netanyahu's speech. So how do you see the whole equation playing out right now?
Yes, so there are two ways to look at it. One is our relationship with the American establishment and leadership, and the other is public opinion. I think at this point, it's fair to say that Netanyahu is simply waiting for Biden to leave. He's banking on a Trump victory in the Trump presidency, who will be more favorable. The war in Gaza has more or less come to a standstill. We have not finished off Hamas forces. Yahya Sinwar, Hamas leader, is still alive. Part of it is because Netanyahu, we are waiting for, you know, we have to ensure a supply of armaments. And that is also the same reason that the war with Hezbollah in Lebanon hasn't really fully started. So Netanyahu, I don't think he's just waiting for Biden to leave. He's banking on Trump. Therefore, Kamala Harris's hostility matters less. Objectively, he doesn't think she has a chance of winning. As to the American public, the public support for Israel is still strong. It might not seem that way because the mainstream media is biased against Israel, but the majority of Americans still support Israel. And when they saw in the protests outside Netanyahu's speech, where supporters were burning American flags and vandalizing national monuments, writing on them, "Hamas is coming," that scores very negatively in American public opinion. And even Kamala Harris was distancing herself from these people.
All right. So you're saying that he's banking on a Trump victory. Do you think Trump will be more supportive? Because even Trump, ahead of their meeting, they're due to meet today, he also said, you know, that the war should be wrapped up soon and people should move on. So do you think that he will actually be more supportive towards this?
Yes, I think, first of all, it should be stated clearly the war, people tend to concentrate on the humanitarian crisis and numbers of casualties and things like that. But the thing to focus on most of all is the outcome, what victory looks like against Hamas, because we don't want to have, just as the Hamas leadership, Ghazi Hamad, said to the press that in Lebanon and similar press to the New York Times, that they want to have October 7th again and again. So we have to ensure that doesn't happen. That means victory has to be complete. The Hamas leadership has to be captured, killed, tried for war crimes, and hanged. And the difficult point, and this is what Israeli establishment I don't think has a plan for, is a de-radicalization the day after. After World War II, the Allies occupied Germany and Japan for 7 and 9 years. Completely controlling their media and their education system. So I don't know if the Israeli establishment has a plan for the de-radicalization of Gaza, because as is, they are not capable of ruling themselves. The population is thoroughly radicalized and they are hell-bent on war all over again. So that we have to make sure that doesn't happen. At the most fundamental level, the issue would be taking down the entire network of Iranian proxies by taking down Iran itself. So that I don't know what the plans are as far as that is concerned.
You know, at this point in time, Israel is not just up against Hamas, but, you know, kind of up against the whole axis of resistance. So do you think that they have the amount of military support required to actually take this war to the end?
Yeah, so this was a big sticking point with Biden in his speech. Netanyahu for all the praises he heaped upon the Americans, he criticized Biden administration for stopping shipments of ammunition. We know that India was even supplying us some shipments of ammunition, drones and armaments. And I can also say that Israel is producing armaments in an emergency mode around the clock, 24 hours a day. So as to simple, you know, the usual army, you know, low-grade armaments, low-tech armaments, we're producing at record capacity. We seem to have enough. As to Jericho 2 and 3 class ballistic missiles, nobody knows how many Israel has. We have a multi-layered air defense system, which has proved useful, which had proved successful when Iranian missiles arrived. But I don't know what the war is, what the plan is for an all-out war against Iran itself. Hezbollah, the Lebanese militia, has much far greater firepower than Hamas. Hamas has, according to CIA reports, Hamas has only 20,000 projectiles, low-grade missiles, whereas Hezbollah has 150,000, including cruise missiles and Scud missiles. So as to the armaments, it's a question of how expansive the war that the ensuing war will be, if against Hezbollah or against Iran itself.
So, you know, a part of it at least seems to be dependent on, you know, aid from the United States. I just want to understand from you, how do you think everything will play out in two scenarios? A, if the Democrats win, and two, if the Republicans win. How do you think it's going to go forward for Israel?
First of all, I don't think the Democrats have a large chance of winning. Kamala Harris is unpopular in her own party and in the American public at large. So if the Democrats win, we'll see. It's unclear how it will work. Netanyahu is clearly banking on a Republican victory. If and when Trump is elected, he wants to immediately finish off the war in Gaza. Again, it's unclear what the day after will look like, but he wants to finish the war in Gaza. Against Hezbollah, again, there's an analyst consensus that it's not a question of if, but a question of when a full-scale war will break out with Hezbollah. They did not procure those missiles to put them in a museum. So basically, I think there will be a steady supply of armaments. There will be more support for the American government, support for a more complete victory, and not constantly stopping us and saying ceasefires and you have to make a deal. There will be more support for a more comprehensive victory. I think that's the most important part to ensure regional Israel's peace and peace for the Palestinians as well, who will be liberated from these radical forces, and regional stability at large.
All right. So what is the internal situation in Israel like right now? Because the former Israeli president said that Netanyahu is losing support from one of their biggest allies, which is the United States. How popular or unpopular is Netanyahu for this whole Hamas war right now within Israel?
First of all, former Prime Minister Yair Lapid is a populist. I don't think he's ideologically too committed I wouldn't take his statements too seriously. He's not a great political strategist. Netanyahu, initially, when the war broke out, it was clear that Netanyahu had no political future, that he would finish the war and resign. His political fortunes have risen a bit since then. Personally, I still think, again, this is my own personal opinion, I don't think that he will be reelected when elections come, but it's unclear. There is large resentment against him in his own party as well. It's a question of who can replace him and in what format. Maybe a new right-wing party will be formed with former Prime Minister Naftali Bennett and others. The situation in general in the Israeli public is that there is a consensus. The war itself is a consensus. People believe, even people who are staunch opponents of Netanyahu the day before the war and remain staunch opponents of Netanyahu, believe that the war should be fought till complete victory. Even though there is a dispute what complete victory looks like, the one lobby that is agitating the strongest against Netanyahu is the lobby of the families of the hostages, who believe that a deal should be struck even at the expense of ending the war prematurely. This is a controversial opinion in Israel. I would say it's a slight minority. Yeah, even though it's highly supported by the media. The media resonates these voices of the families of the hostages, but the public at large wants to see complete victory. That I think that's pretty clear in the surveys.
Okay, so largely you would say his own party may be sort of turning against him, but the public at large is pro Netanyahu.
No, let me
at least pro the moves.
Let me just correct that. His own party, Netanyahu, does not like internal opposition in his own party. He has removed from the party in previous years anyone who was too independent, had too much independent thought. So his party is composed primarily of yes men. That said, so in his party, he has, within his party, the politicians in his party, he has relatively little opposition. His voters, are mad at him. And we see that in the polls that Likud would get far fewer votes than it does today. And the public at large, many people are mad at Netanyahu. Even some of his most loyal journalists have since abandoned him and say that Netanyahu had a great career and it ended with a serious flaw in the October 7th massacre. So there is, I would say, resentment against Netanyahu in the greater public. It's unclear how this will play out in the polls. And this is primarily dependent upon what will replace him. Because if there will be an alternative right of center party to Likud, it would most probably win the elections and not the left of center parties.
End with one question that as per records, over 39,000 people have been killed in Gaza during this whole war. So like how and where does this end? Like, what is your view on the humanitarian crisis that is taking place there right now?
Yes. So first of all, I would like to quote Brigadier General in Reserves Ophir Winter, who said that humanitarian aid is managed in the wrong way. What should be done is creating a humanitarian zone completely administered by Israel, in which only there humanitarian aid is given out. And anyone who is not in that zone, meaning Hamas fighters, will not get any humanitarian aid. And that would bring the war to a prompt close. As to the numbers, we saw in the Lancet magazine, the medical bulletin, radical activist doctors gave even a number of 186,000 casualties. This was comprehensively debunked on the Honest reporting site. And I suggest reading their figures also on the figure of 39,000. What is not pointed out, first of all, it should be said that the UN Office for Coordination and Humanitarian Affairs had, on May 9th, had cut that number in half. In other words, 39,000 was the figure that Hamas officials had given them, and they had realized that figure was not reliable. Even if it is in the vicinity of reliability, roughly half of those, if it's according to Israeli figures, it's roughly around 15,000, are Hamas fighters, people who have been killed in battle, combat age men killed in battle. Therefore, the statistic of women and children being 70% of the casualties is patently false, is statistically impossible. So I suggest, first of all, taking the numbers with a grain of salt. And also we should note that even if those numbers are correct, which I believe they are not, still the ratio of roughly 1-to-1, one combatant for one civilian, is lowest in the history of modern warfare, especially in such difficult urban warfare, as the world's leading expert on urban warfare, John Spencer, has pointed out.
Right. Well, Yesha, that was extremely insightful. Thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you very much.